commence primary ignition.
Hey everyone, we're playing with lasers. This comes with a safety warning. I'm using a low powered 5mW laser diode that you would normally find in a typical laser pointer, but there are some extremely powerful lasers available for sale online. Lasers are dangerous and come with potentially life-changing risks. Do not look directly at the laser and beware of reflective surfaces. Having said that, if you are careful and stick to low power devices, you can have a lot of fun. In this project, I'm using a laser galvanometer, often shortened to just laser galvo. You can find these on eBay for between £70 to £80, which is around $100. Looking closely at the device, we can see that it consists of two mirrors at right angles. Shining a laser beam at one of the mirrors lets us direct the beam in the X and Y directions. I've linked to a great video in the comments that tears down various galvo motors so you can see what's inside. The basic operation is a magnetic core with coils, coupled with a feedback mechanism to sense the rotation of the shaft. In this image we can see the feedback mechanism. They have an infrared diode with two detectors. As the shaft rotates, the amount of light falling on the detectors changes. The driver circuitry is pretty complicated with a lot of non-linearity, so it's best not to mess with all the potentiometers as these are normally calibrated at the factory. To interface with the driver board, we need to provide a differential signal with a peak-to-peak value of minus 5 volts to plus 5 volts. We also need to provide samples at a sufficient sample rate to move the laser fast enough to take advantage of persistence of vision. I'm going to be using 20 kHz, which seems to be what my boards have been calibrated at. Now, normally we'd use I2S for outputting samples at this rate, but we have some extra complexity. We need to turn the laser off and on synchronously with sending samples out. I2S uses DMA, so this would be quite difficult to do without jumping through a lot of hoops. I2C is not really fast enough, so we're left with SPI as the best option. So I'm going to use the MCP4822, which is a dual channel 12-bit digital to analog converter with an SPI interface. This will output a value between 0 and 4.096 volts, so we'll need some extra circuitry to convert this to the differential output required by the driver boards. Let's have a look at the schematic. Now I've had this board manufactured as a custom PCB, but you can easily build this on breadboard. We have the power supply coming in. I'm using the power supply that comes with the laser galvo kit, and I've added an extra header so we can daisy chain devices on top of this. So this gives us a plus 15 volts ground and minus 15 volts. I'm passing the input voltages through an LC filter to remove any noise. This is probably not really necessary, and I'll replace it in future versions with a simple choke. To power the DAC, we need 5 volts. This will let us give it the full output range of 0 volts to 4.096 volts. I'm using a 5 volt low dropout regulator here. We don't need much current, so this won't get too hot. Here's the DAC circuit. It's pretty simple. We have a decoupling capacitor and a couple of filter capacitors on the outputs. These help to remove any clock noise that may come through from the digital interface. Can now move on to processing this signal into a differential signal to drive the galvos. The first thing we'll need is a voltage reference of 2.048 volts. Now you could use a voltage divider here, but I'm using an ADR 5040, which will give us a reference voltage of exactly 2.048 volts. Now before I use this reference voltage, I'm passing it through a voltage follower so that it gets buffered. We pass the left and right channels from the DAC through a voltage subtractor. This subtracts the voltage reference and also amplifies the signal by a factor of 2. The output of this gives us the positive side of the left and right channels. We feed these two signals into an inverting amplifier with unity gain, and this gives us the negative sides of the left and right channels. So that's the analog side of our circuitry done. To control the laser, we use a simple MOSFET circuit. When the L on signal is high, the laser will be turned on, and when it's low, the laser will be turned off. JLC PCB are now SMT assembling ESP32 modules, so I've added a rover module to my schematic. To power this, I've got a 3.3 volts regulator. I'd normally use something like the AMS117, which can handle the 15 volts input, but instead I'm trying out one of these little switch circuit modules that are pin-for-pin compatible and are much more efficient and don't generate quite so much heat. The wiring of the module is pretty straightforward. I'm not doing anything fancy with the RTS and DTS lines, so programming is a case of tying IO0 to ground and then power cycling. JLC PCB have just announced support for USB connectors, so I think revision 2 of this board will probably just include a USB socket and a USB to UART chip. The PCB layout is pretty simple. I put the DAC very close to the ESP32 and tried to keep the analog circuitry away from the digital circuitry. I've ended up with a 4-layer board. I did manage to route it on 2 layers, but it was pretty horrible, and the price difference for a small run is not that much. So the top layer contains all our signal traces, the next layer contains a ground plane, and I've used the other layers as power planes. Having 4 layers does massively simplify the layout process. Here's the completed circuit board from JLC PCB. Now, the observant of you may notice a small bodge wire. My first revision of the schematic had a bit of a stupid error. I thought I'd wired pin 3 on the voltage reference to pin 1, which is what the datasheet recommends to do, but I hadn't actually connected the wires. The red circle was missing. Unfortunately, this didn't get flagged up by the software, as all the pins were connected. But luckily, this is an easy fix. On the software side, I've written a very basic laser show player. I'm using Platform IO for this project and the esp-idf. But the code should work on Arduino as well. There is a standard format for laser shows, which has been defined by the International Laser Display Association. Reading these files is reasonably straightforward, and we can use similar code to what we use for reading WAV files. We have an ILDA header structure, and we have an ILDA record structure. These can both be read directly from the file. The only thing we need to check when reading these structures is that the byte ordering matches. To actually read the file, we first read in the first header. This tells us how many frames are in the file, and then the file just consists of multiple ILDA headers followed by multiple ILDA records. To fit more data onto the SPIFS partition, I'm gzipping the ILDA files. To decompress these, I'm using code from zlib. I have a simple wrapper around this that will read uncompressed data from the gzip file. When we open the file, we read a small chunk of data and initialize zlib, and then to read data, we tell zlib how many bytes we want and where to put them. We then repeatedly call inflate until it has decompressed the required number of bytes. If needed, we read in more data from the file. With the data read into memory, we can now play the show. We have 2 output pins, the pin to turn the laser off and on, and the pin to tell the MCP4822 to output the new voltages. We use this to make sure that the left and right channels are updated simultaneously. We set up the SPI device with the required pins, and then kick off a timer to actually output the samples. In the timer, we send each sample out using SPI device polling transmit. This is the fastest way to send out SPI commands synchronously. We set the state of the laser depending on the instructions in the ILDA file, and then we pulse the LDAC line low to output the new voltages on the DAC. So that's our laser show done. All the code's in GitHub. This is a very basic implementation. There are a lot of things that could be done to improve it. We're limited on the length of show by storing the ILDA files in SPIFs. It would be much better to add support for an SD card and read the files from there. We could even stream the files from a server. I'm using a Rover module, and I've configured the IDF to use the extra RAM for malloc. If you're using Arduino, then you'll probably need to use psmalloc if you have a Rover module. I've also not been very careful in my memory usage, so running this code on a Vroom is probably possible, but you may have to be a bit more careful and stick to fairly small ILDA files. Anyway, thanks for watching. I'm working on another project using the laser projector, which I'm pretty excited about. Don't forget to subscribe, and I'll see you in the next video.